Hi, it's Paul Andersen, and this is Crosscutting Concept 2. It's cause and effect. Cause and effect is innate in humans. In other words, from a young age, we want to know why something occurs. In other words, what causes the ripples on the pond? We want to know that mechanism. We want to explain why it occurs. And so it's innate in us, but it's something that we also want to develop in a science classroom. Because in science, cause and effect allows us to explain causal relationships. This affects that. And in engineering, it's a little bit different. We want to be in control of the cause so we can also control the effect, especially in a design. And so when you're presented with a question, cause and effect comes right away. And so let me give you a good question. This is a rattleback. A rattleback is a piece of plastic that has a unique behavior. And so in this video, what I'm going to do is I'm going to spin the rattleback and it will spin. I'm then going to try to spin it in the opposite direction, and it will rattle, and then it will come back again. Let me try that again. So I'm going to spin it like this. It's going to rattle, and then it's going to spin back. And it wants to spin that way so much that if you just touch it, it'll start to spin that direction. Okay, now I've given you a good question, and so what you should be thinking is what's causing that rattleback to have that behavior? In other words, is it a magnet that's in here? Is it somehow asymmetrical? Is it somehow a weight inside of it? And so our mind jumps to this idea of cause and effect. But one thing that we want to make sure that students understand is that if we're saying A causes B, then we have to have a chain of interactions from A to B. In other words, we want to link A to B. We really want to make sure that A is causing B. And sometimes that's super simple. So if you see a home run, in other words, a baseball go over a fence, you know the cause of that home run. It's the bat that hit the ball because you can physically see it. And so now you have a nice chain of interaction. Since we can see that and we could video that bat impacting on the ball, we can say that A is actually causing B. But sometimes it's unclear. And so for a long history of humanity, we didn't know what causes disease. We didn't know what causes chickenpox, for example. A lot of people thought it was just bad air. And if you would have said to somebody that there's something on your hands that's causing that disease, and so you need to wash your hands, people back then would have been skeptical. And the reason they would have been skeptical is that there's no chain of interaction. There's not anything that we can see that's linking the washing of your hands to a decrease in those infectious diseases. And until we had studies where we could actually prove that, or we could see the virus, we could see the bacteria, we really couldn't say that A causes B. And sometimes those causes are really complex. And so if we were to look at an ecosystem, for example, or if we were to look at climate, global warming is a great example of that. We know that the climate is getting warmer, so we can see that in the geologic, or we can see that in the record, but we don't know specifically all the causes of that. We know that carbon dioxide is one of the big ones, greenhouse gas is one of the big ones, but there's so many variables at play, it's hard to tell what are all of the causes. And also, sometimes it's just a probability. So if you're looking at a particle, what's the probability that that we're going to get radioactive decay? What's the odds of that? Well, you can predict, you have a probability of how often that's going to occur in a specific period of time, but we can't say it's going to happen right now, and here's the cause, and here's going to be the effect. And so one thing that we want to make sure when we're talking at this root level of cause and effect, this idea of universality, and it's an assumption that we make. In other words, in the universe, there are four basic forces, and those forces are gravity, electromagnetism, and then the strong and the weak nuclear forces. And so basically, we're going to assume that the universe is the same here as it is everywhere. We're going to assume universality, that these forces are the same everywhere. And that's actually a pretty big assumption. One other thing that we want to make sure we're talking about is the scale. And so if we're looking at something at a large scale, like climate, or let's get a little smaller, let's say the structure of this protein right here, well, that's definitely determined by all of the atoms that are found within that protein. But even though we understand all of these interactions at this small scale, that doesn't mean we can predict what's going to happen at the large scale, even though what happens at the large scale can't violate those rules at the small scale. And so what's the goal in a science classroom? We want to make sure that our students are starting to see causation or link causation, cause and effect. Example, we would want them to see patterns right away in the early elementary grades, and then we want to explain the unexpected. And so when you see that rattleback spin, that's a great example of something that you would want to present your students with so they can come up with a lot of different causes that we can then test. We then want to move on to argumentation. So as we move into middle school and high school, not only do we want them to put forward a cause, but we want to argue for that and give evidence for that. And so examples could be, let's apply theories to things that we're seeing. Let's apply laws that we have, laws of nature, to observations that we make. And then we want to do that with observed phenomena, so actually seeing what's occurring, and then trying to explain all of the causes that may occur, and then try to make argumentation from that. And so where would this occur at the early elementary grades? We want to basically start sensing patterns, and we want to take those patterns and then try to link those to a cause. So a great example could be plant growth. And so you could have kids growing plants, and then we could see what's affecting that. So water is clearly going to affect plant growth, they might say. Light is going to affect plant growth. But you want to come up with as many different causes as you can. You want them listing those causes out. And then as we move into greater, older grades, especially in elementary, we want to present them with weird observations. In other words, we want to present them with discrepant events. And so a great example of one could be the moon. And so the moon is going to go through phases. And so a good question is, if the moon looks like this, how are the moon and the earth organized so that you can get something like that? And it's a great thing you could do in the classroom, where you take a model of the moon, you have a light source, and you can kind of figure out, where do I have to hold the moon if I'm the earth to get a shape that looks like that? As we move into middle school and high school, we want to start using argumentation. In other words, we want to go to theories, established theories, to explain phenomena. And so why a lever works, we could go over that in a classroom, but then we could present them with phenomena, and then they're going to try to explain that. And so that's a great one that I've done in class, where you put, once they learn that the load and the distance from the fulcrum is related, you can give them a load on one side and predict how far a load has to be on the other side so that you can get it to balance. And then we want to give them harder problems as they move through high school. And so this is a dead zone. For example, it's in the Gulf of Mexico. And every year we have this area in the ocean where everything dies. And that's because of decreased oxygen levels. And so you want them to come up with as many different causes as there possibly could be. You want to list all of those. And so then we can start doing some research, or we can start doing some testing to see which of those causes are correct. So cause and effect, it's innate in us. It's really cool. And so are rattlebacks. And I hope that was helpful.